contact is Qi-Kun Xue. And since the title of this talk here is TBA, and I don't know what it is, and I guess it's better to look on the screen, and maybe we'll just let him introduce his talk. So
okay.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much. Also, I would like to thank the organizer for inviting me here. Actually, this workshop is, for the Xin Center, operated by the Tel Aviv University and the Tsinghua University. I'm very sorry, several of our faculty couldn't make this trip to give a talk. For that, I really apologize. And also, I like to acknowledge all the speakers coming for this winter school. For this very strong support for this school and for the collaboration between Tel Aviv University and Tsinghua University. So do I have the point? Yeah. Yeah. So today, I like to talk about the title of my talk is Atomic Level Control of Two-Dimensional Material Growth. So since we have a lot of the students, I really focus on the, focus on the MB growth of the materials, which is two-dimensional. Then to highlight this importance of the material growth, I will talk about the quantized anomalous Hall effect in the topological insulator. Also, another one is for the high temperature superconductivity, which promoted and enhanced by the interface engineering. And I will give an introduction, then I will talk about the quantized anomalous Hall effect, and also the third, I will talk about the interface enhanced high temperature superconductivity in the single unit cell of ion selenide on STO, the strontium titanium oxide substrate. Let me start by the stressing the very important, point about the control for materials. So let me start. This is a very old paper published in 1998. So talking about the conductivity or the transport of silicon or the materials as a function of doping or as a function of the impurity of the materials. If you look at the silicon, this is the resistivity of different materials. So we focus on the silicon, which is well known the semiconductor materials. So for the very high quality silicon, we call the intrinsic silicon, which is the ultra pure, the resistivity around the 10 to the minus 5, so ohm the centimeter. If you have the one dopant per million silicon atom, still that's a very high purity silicon. One impurity or one dopant per billion silicon atom. So then the resistivity drop from minus 10 to the 5 to the 10 to the 2, so three order change. If we increase the doping to the level with the one doping per million silicon atom, again, this is still very high quality silicon, then the resistivity of the silicon drop to the 10 to the minus 2. So from the intrinsic silicon to this quality silicon, so the resistivity changes 7 orders. So this indicates how the quality of materials affect the transport or the electricity of our materials. So silicon, the band gap is the 1. Something, right? 1.2 or something. If you turn to the gallium arsenide, even many of the famous the gallium nitride, you have a similar behavior. So in any case, the good thing is the semiconductor is so industry is so advanced. So you can easily, if you ask the very high quality silicon for the high performance solar cell, you can ask the 12-9 purity silicon. That can easily not easily, but is commercially available in many the company. Okay? Also, the density of the defect is very low. So in any case, what I emphasize here is that, you know, the material control is so critical for the, you know, semiconductor. And actually, this importance can be further, you know, the highlighted by the discovery of integer quantum Hall effect and a fractional quantum Hall effect, where the, you have this two-dimensional electron gas. So took, you know, this made by this MB, the molecular beam epitaxy modulating doping. So what they did is we have the, this intrinsic or the semi-insulating gallium arsenide, which is of the very high quality without any doping. We call the semi-insulating gallium arsenide. On top of this gallium arsenide substrate, we grew this wide band gap aluminum gallium arsenide, okay? So these two materials lattice matched, so you can make the atomic sharp interface. So to create the two-dimensional electron gas, you dope the gallium arsenide, for example, by the silicon. If the silicon atom replace aluminum or gallium, they will create one electron. The electron, resulting electron will be automatically injected from this doping side to the, you know, the side of gallium arsenide. This side closes the interface. Because the gallium arsenide is the perfect material without any impurity doping, so the mobility of the electron coming from this charged reservoir layer is very, very high. So can you reach, I think in the Israel, you can reach the mobility with several 10 to the 7 centimeter square per watt second, okay? That means the free, the mean free path of an electron can go to the 1 millimeter, so without any scattering. So this is another, you know, thing about the quality of materials is so important. And the result, we have this high, since we have very high mobility for the electron, two-dimensional electron gas, that's why we can observe the integer or the fractional quantum Hall effect. So the high quality material is, again, very important. The doping control or the impurity control is so essential here. Then we turn to the another very important field. High temperature superconductivity discovered nearly 30 years ago, cuprate. Cuprate, the high temperature superconductivity is made by doping of apparent insulator. Insulator band structure is same as the, that of the semiconductor. So by the doping of this insulator, so take the this lithium strontium copper oxide as an example, we have the copper oxide, which is a perfect layer, which is the superconducting layer. And then on both sides of copper oxide, you have the lithium oxide, which is a wide band gap materials, is oxide. Then you replace some of the lithium atom with strontium, and then you create the, you call the doping. The resulting carrier will be automatically injected, just like the this is the heterostructure I mentioned in the last slide, into this copper oxide form the superconductivity. So means the doping take place, occur in this charged reservoir layer, but the superconductivity take, occurred at the copper oxide layer, which is perfect, same to the gallium arsenide in the last slide for two-dimensional gas. So the difference, or the difference between this system and the quantum Hall system, two-dimensional gas, is the only difference, yeah, if you see the real difference is the density of a charge different. So here you have the liquid, because you need the density very high to form the metallic state to form the superconductivity. In the two-dimensional gas case, the carrier density is lower. So you see where. So basically, the ion-based superconductor have the similar thing. You have this perfect iron arsenide layer as a superconducting layer, but the carrier come from this both side, you know, charged reservoir layer, like the lithium oxide, and very similar to this case. So basically, quantum Hall effect and superconductivity in the structure, very similar, only difference is a carrier density change. So this, of course, there are many other differences. This is the main difference to me. So in this case, since I talk about the doping control in the silicon, then the immediate question for the cuprate is how precisely we control the doping of the cuprate. If you ask the best single crystal grower, material scientist, now the best single crystal for the cuprate is this biscol, bismuth, strontium, calcium, carbon, oxide, this lay. So this is the best crystal for the cuprate. So if you ask the expert, how much you can control of this the carrier density. So you can see this is the chemical pricing here. The X is the uncertainty of the oxygen composition. If you ask, the answer is maybe the few percent or at best a few tenths percent. So means even the fluctuation of the charge, in this case, in the level of the 10 to the 20 or 10 to 19. So this is the uncertainty or fluctuation in the carrier density. So basically, so for compare the high temperature superconductivity and the two-dimensional gas in the silicon and the gallium arsenide, we have quite a poor control of the carrier density. So fluctuation already the 10 to the 19 or the 20 per centimeter cubic. So this is the difference in the quality of the cuprate and a semiconductor like gallium arsenide silicon. Of course, this is not because of our material science not great, simply because this oxide is so difficult to control and prepare with such kind of precise control of the carrier density. So as a result, even after 30 years, more than 400,000 papers published to understand the mechanism of high TC, still no answer. So if you look at the carrier density, the transition temperature and the functional transition density, they are dome, they are all triangle, some of the not quantitatively understand the behavior or TC dependence on the carrier density. So you have the pseudo gap and the charge all the very, very complicated phase diagram. But those kind of phase diagram based on the some just individual experiment data, they make some dome or structure. So, but to solve the problem, I think we need to do something like a semiconductor, okay? So I just take another example, the topological insulator, to indicate the importance of this kind of control for the quality or carrier density or the material, the crystalline property to emphasize the if you want to study the even the topological insulator. You know, topological insulator was discovered around 10 years ago. So there are some of the review by the pioneer of this field. Also the younger pioneer, Professor Fu from MIT also in the meeting. So topological insulator, since they will discuss in this meeting, the score very much. I will not go to the detail. In any case, from the point of application, this is a good material for the low power consumption electronics, even the spintronic, since the diacritic is fully spin polarized. Also, there are a lot of exotic, the intriguing quantum phenomena to study with, such as the quantum spin hole effect. Professor Molin Kappa is here. Also, the quantized anomalous Hall effect, Marona fermion, the magnetic monopole, and so on. A lot of exciting physics and also potential application already proposed for a topological insulator. So, my group started working on this field by after the theoretical prediction of these three-dimensional materials, the bismuth selenide, bismuth telluride, and antimony telluride. So look at the bismuth oxide. So this is the conducting band. This is the valence band. The separation between these two bands around 0.3 eV is much smaller than the standard silicon band gap. So this is a very easy to conduct materials. And by including the spin orbital coupling, you see this beautiful diacritic. Okay, so I think they will listen a lot of talk related to this one. I just show you we are working on these layered materials. This selenium atom, bismuth selenium, bismuth selenium. This within this five layer, the atom interaction is very strong, is of covalence bonding. And between this five layer and this five quintuple layer, the interaction very weak. So this is a layered material. So if you cleave the single crystal for this one, then the cleave the surface will be the this here. Okay. So the theory and experiment done by the you know Professor Hassan's group and Princeton, and the theory also at the Stanford University by the Shou Cheng. So I just you know these materials. I just show you the data about the first apex band structure measurement. So this is done by the Professor Shen's group at Stanford University. Use apex to measure the single crystal bismuth telluride prepared by this great scientist, Professor Fischer, at the same university. So you can see this conducting band, valence band. More importantly, you see this beautiful Dirac cone. So this is a topological metallic gapless state. And the same thing done by this for this bismuth selenide. So the single crystal, which is a very high quality prepared by Professor Kawa at Princeton, measured by Hassan's group. Again, you see the conducting band, valence band. So you, in between, within the gap, you have this gapless Dirac cone, you know, band. So this is well known, okay? What I want to point out here is if you look at the Fermi surface, this is the Fermi surface, the Fermi energy, around the Fermi energy, you have a very strong signal from a conducting band. By definition, topological insulator is a bulk insulator. Near the Fermi energy, no electronic states. So here, obviously, the Fermi energy located deeply in the conducting band. This, in the language of semiconductor, is an N-type semiconductor. So, okay. So if we really want to study the transport property of the bismuth selenide, we need move this Fermi energy into the gap. So the Fermi, near the Fermi energy, we only have this Dirac cone, you know, topological states. That's what we want. But now, look at this one, and this one, and this one. All the Fermi energy located in the conducting band. So if you measure the transport property, the property will come from the combination of bulk states, conducting band, and also the Dirac cone states. Okay? So you cannot distinguish each other. So you need to get rid of this, you know, move this Fermi energy, you know, into the gap. So the reason for how this kind of the situation is that we have very high density of selenium vacancy in the single crystal. So they are expert of the single crystal growth, but due to the intrinsic property of this growth, you still have a very high density of selenium vacancy, which make your materials heavily N-type doped. And of course, Professor Hassan used the you know, nitrogen oxide molecule, this NO molecule, to you know, to change the band structure. They can, you know, this as ground is N-type conductor, but after a certain amount of the NO adsorption, so they can shift the Fermi energy into the gap. Of course, this is the one for method to change the band structure, to change the conductivity of the bulk. So after the go through the three very important systems, two-dimensional gas, and high temperature superconductivity, and the topological insulator, obviously, if you really want to study the physics there, you need a very high quality materials. You need a very high, you know, precise control of the carrier or the impurity level, just like what we did for silicon and gallium arsenide. Regardless it's cuprate, regardless it's topological bismuth selenide or antimony telluride. So this is essential. As an experimentalist, you need to think of very, very carefully, okay? So today, I just, in the rest part of my talk, I just show you what kind of approach can be used to address these kind of things. So to control the transport of materials, to study the, you know, the exotic physics, And to find some application, potential application, we need, again, we have to work from the very beginning of the science matures. You need a precise control of the doping, the impurity, or the crystal quality of the matures. So for that purpose, you know, since I was trained in the semiconductor 3.5, so that time we already have a very good technique of molecular beam epitaxy. And later on, and also I'm working for more than almost 30 years on the scanning tunneling microscope. So with MBE, you can grow the matures layer, atomic layer by atomic layer, okay? In the ultra high vacuum, in the very clean environment. With STM, you can see the individual atom. If you can see the, you know, in the vacuum, you see the band structure, the local density of states. So if you further combine this apex angle resolved photoemission spectroscopy to for the band structure measurement, basically you can control your material at atomic level. You can control, basically measure your material, yeah, the band structure or electronic property in the atomic scale. So my group have been working on this MB combined STM and apex for a long time. So I just show you one of the machine from Omicron and Sienta. So this MB system and STM and apex, you connect this chamber, and this chamber in ultra-high vacuum. So after growth of the sample by MB, you can immediately take your sample to the STM to see the atomic structure, to see the local density of states, and then you can check by apex the band structure. So you know what kind of defect there. You by the MB growth, this feedback control, and growth and check, growth and check, then you can nail down the origin of this the defect. Then you can find the best condition to grow the best materials. So I just show you in the rest part, we use this combined technique of MB, STM, apex, and also the ex situ transporter working on the topological insulator. As a result, about 2.5 years ago, my group realized this quantized anomalous Hall effect. And also recently, probably we are by this technique, we see the evidence of the second high TC system with the TC. Yeah, probably higher than 77 Kelvin at the ambient condition. Okay, I just show you how this powerful technique can be applied to these two very important fields. So quantum anomaly Hall effect. So I just show you this is the MBE growth, show the MBE growth of bismuth selenide. This is a low vapor pressure element, high vapor pressure, similar to gallium arsenide. Gallium is a low vapor pressure element. Arsenic is a very volatile, high vapor pressure element, similar to this one. You use the condition for the 3.5 gallium arsenide applied to this one, you immediately see this read oscillation. Professor Huang in the morning showed the read oscillation. Read oscillation, the diffraction oscillation means the, you know, layer by layer growth. Here, one cycle of the oscillation means indicate a deposition of one quintuple layer materials. And also from the diffraction pattern, you see the diffraction streak is very long, means the morphology is flat. And you have a very flat morphology, and at the same time, you have a layer by layer growth by this oscillation. And then, since we have this STM, we move the sample into the STM chamber, check the morphology. You see the 200 nanometer by 200 nanometer, we have 1, 2, 3 atomic steps. So this is the typical morphology of best silicon materials. So it means we can grow the bismuth selenide by MB with a quality similar to the silicon. And then on the terrace, you zoom in, you see the individual atom. In this case, one bright spot corresponds to the single selenium atom on the surface. Most importantly, you don't see any defect. If you have a defect on the surface, the contrast of STM will change. We have no. And then we immediately move this sample into the apex chamber to check the band structure. You can see this Dirac cone, this Fermi energy. Near the Fermi energy, we don't have this conducting band. Means our Fermi energy of this material located a bulk gap. Only near the Fermi energy, there is only Dirac cone. This is the topological states over there. So if you measure the transport property, so since the property is mainly from the electronic states near the Fermi energy, you can get the information from these topological states. You don't need to worry about the bulk trivial states. So this is a powerful technique, I show the power of the STM combined MBE. And then for the, in the case of the bismuth, we can really control atomic layer the band structure. This after the growth of one queen tube layer, about 1 nanometer thick, and 2 and 3 and 4 and 5, you can see, and 6, you see the formation of a Dirac cone. You can exactly determine at what kind of thickness this material become topological. Below this 5 queen tube layer, you have the gap. That's the typical the semiconducting materials. Of course, you can go through many hours if you work very hard. And I just show you the case of bismuth telluride. Again, after MB growth, you see the half micron by half micron, you have 1, 2, 3, 4 atomic steps. Very similar to the morphology of the high quality gallium arsenide. You know, I work on gallium arsenide almost 10 years. If you see this kind of surface, very flat. Then if you zoom in, you see the individual atom. Again, there is no defect, or very, very few defect. If you have a defect, the contrast will be changed. Then we measure the, transfer the sample into the optic chamber, you measure the band structure. When it's band Dirac cone, the conductance probably is here. So the Fermi energy located the bulk gap. That is the materials what we want for the topological insulator. Okay. Again, we also work on, so I will go not, so as a result, since we have such a high quality thin film prepared by MB, using the low temperature, high magnetic field, STM, we can really, like Professor Kapchunik, we did a similar experiment published in the 2009. We used the quantum interference in the STM to demonstrate experimentally the absence of a band scattering predicted by theory. Okay, since you see that the quantum interference, the quasi-particle interference is beautiful because the material is so good. And also, if you apply magnetic field, you see this Landau quantized unevenly spaced thing. That means that this topological state is a massless Dirac fermion and so on. So basically, everything done because of the high quality materials. Okay. So this is, I want to emphasize. So now, look like the material is good. We can really the. By STM, we didn't really find that this edge state. So the edge, I will show the transporter, maybe the quantized anomalous hole. That's the, near the even the step and the defect, we don't see something, don't see very special thing for this experiment. So now I just show you that since the material is good, again, to realize this quantized anomalous hole effect, we even have a much better or even the higher precise control of the material quality, okay? So the importance of a quantized anomalous hole effect can be seen by this figure. I just show you Hole effect was discovered in 1879. 100 years later, integer quantum Hole effect, fractional quantum Hole effect, or half integer quantum Hole effect was discovered at the two-dimensional gas at this silicon oxide, silicon interface, and gallium arsenide, aluminum gallium arsenide interface, also this massless graphene. So basically, this one, you need a magnetic field, okay? Hole effect, you need a magnetic field. Quantization of a Hole also need a magnetic field. So you know that 1 year later, Hall did another experiment with the magnetic materials. So they discovered this anomalous Hall effect without need of magnetic field. So that if you see this kind of, we have so many quantization of the quantum Hall effect, why we have no quantization anomalous Hall effect? So before, we don't have this kind of, you know, idea. After the proposal, the discovery of the topological insulator or the other theoretical particular thing, so now we have the materials for this experiment. So I think I will not go to theory. The earlier theory is the graphene with this broken time reversal symmetry proposed by Hadan, later on Shou Cheng and Nagaosa and Professor Niu all proposed give some proposal for the quantized anomalous Hall effect. So since my group is a collaborator with Professor Zhang Shou Cheng for the three-dimensional doping of the three-dimensional topological insulator with magnetic doping. So I just show you this, you know, if you introduce the ferromagnetic ordering into the three-dimensional topological insulator, you can open the gap. This gap, each side of the gap can carry the half of, you know, quantum conductance. Then if you make the film is very, very thin, then because the top surface and bottom surface have a different topology, then you can get the edge conductivity, and you indicated is quantized. So I think I have no time to explain. So what I want to emphasize, particularly for the student, is first, you have to, your starting material must be very great. Insulating topological insulator, I already show you. Next, if you do the magnetic doping, you need to make a ferromagnetic bulk insulating topological insulator. Again, you need a bulk insulating. Since the, if you talk magnetic metal is always increase the conductivity of materials. So this is even much harder. So if all the things are satisfied, even without application, even the no magnetic field, you will see the quantization of the, you know, this Hall resistance. So we use our combined machine. So to realize this quantized anomalous Hall effect, we need a very good control. We need to grow the insulating the ferromagnetic topological insulator. So to do that, we use this compound, started conducted this chromium doping. What we need to make sure is first that chromium must only, you know, take the lattice side of bismuth or antimony. This can't ion position. Otherwise, you will introduce the extra carrier. Also, you have to make sure at your growth condition, the material growth process, there is no chromium clustering. You know, the manganese doped gallium arsenide is a long time promising for the spintronics, but the materials you get always have some manganese cluster. If you have the magnetic property come from the manganese cluster, that's nothing to do with the dilute magnetic semiconductor. So we also have the similar situation. You make sure during growth there is no chromium cluster which can produce any magnetic ordering. So we did that. We used the low temperature MB, did this chromium doping at this temperature. We have a very good STM. We can check the morphology. Very flat. We can check atomic structure. We see the individual selenium atom, antimony atom, and also the chromium atom. You can see in the area we scan, there is no chromium cluster. Also, the chromium always at the position of this lattice side of bismuth or antimony. So this is what we want. But without this STM command MB, you have to measure the transporter, then you get something wrong or we change. But we have this powerful combination. We can immediately find the material is satisfy what we need. And then, of course, finally, by the many, the, my hard and very smart students hard working, we found this, alloy, chromium, this 15% bismuth antimony telluride, and in any case, so you see the Curie temperature around 50 Kelvin. If we make this the very ugly the whole bar device, but it works, okay. And then at this temperature, we see at a zero magnetic field, you see the full quantization at H over E squared. So this is done almost 3 years ago. So this is correspond in agreement excellently with the theory. So I think after discovery of topological usage, now we have quantized the whole effect without magnetic field. So then together with the quantum spin hole and quantized anomalous, so we completed all the available quantum Hall effect. So at the beginning, many people question our data is maybe fabricated or you are lucky or something. So 1 year later, Professor Tokula at Kawasaki's group at the University of Tokyo and Rikin and used the similar thing but on the different subject, and also Professor Kang Long's group at UCLA in collaborate with other group and say the quantization. So last year, MIT, Professor Modolas group and also Stanford, and I also heard that the Princeton many group see the quantization. I just show you the when the data published last year by Professor Modolas group and MIT used this vanadium doped atom telluride, you see the perfect quantization of a Hall effect without magnetic field. So recently, my group have working how to, so all the data take at a 30 millikelvin temperature. It's too low for the application. So if you can increase the opposition temperature to the 4 Kelvin liquid helium temperature, just like the MRI in the hospital, then maybe you can make some of the expensive chip for the special purpose. So we have some development. You see, by using the co-doping of chromium and vanadium into this one, and we observe the full quantization, perfect quantization at 300 millikelvin, one order for magnitude increased compared to the first experiment. And I think now the around the 1 Kelvin, I work with my students to get the 1 Kelvin, you know, the quantization. Also, we see the some of the zero Hall resistant plateau. That's only related to the magnetic topological insulator. So I will not go to the detail. So how long I have? 10 minutes, so. I think I just want to give some of the particular students, if you want to get the good sample, if you want to do the good experiment, you need a good sample nowadays, okay? Okay. So the next experiment is just we try to measure the parasymmetry by STM on the copper oxide superconducting layer. Because now the most experiment on the cuprate done by the cleaved surface in the vacuum, and but that is the bismuth oxide terminated surface. So we want to measure directly the copper oxide superconducting layer. So since this guy is very tough, we change this one to this one, and one unit cell, one layer of selenium on the STO, so very similar. So by the, we expect by the charge transfer from this substrate into this one, just like the, by the charge of electron injecting into the copper oxide layer, we see the high TC. That's the first idea. We did this monolayer ion selenide on the STO. That's just want to simulate this system. Of course, my group is also working on this one. Maybe next time I can report some of the direct measurement of superconductivity on the copper oxide. The results will be very different from the cleaved surface. So I think that this interface enhanced the superconductivity already discussed in this conference. Professor John Mahart and also the Professor Howard Huang talk about the system. Actually, this interface enhancement already reported in the 1968. At the time, I was very small. So again, you have to find the condition, get the best single crystal film of ion selenide by MBE. So this I just show the MBE layer by layer, atomic layer by layer growth of ion selenide superconducting film on silicon carbide, on graphene, on gallium arsenide, on STO. So this is the Y unit cell, and if you zoom in, no defect, and a second, and a third, and a fourth, similar to the bismuth selenide. You can control your superconducting film as with a quality compatible to the silicon or semiconductor. So this is again show the power. Not our students is good. This technique is great. So we can control the composition by simply changing the flux ratio between the selenium and the iron. So the superconducting, this is the metallic, and maybe insulating. That we can easily control in the vacuum, in the MB chamber. And also, even for this potassium-doped iron selenide, you can see the morphology is perfect. If you do the, you know, density states, the differential conduction measurement at a different location, you see the superconducting gap is very, very uniform. Okay? So with this kind of sample, you can talk about the really pairing mechanism or superconducting mechanism. And yeah, I think recent development, we just used the surface technique to remove the each layer of the cuprate, layer by layer mapping of electronic of bisco. So the one conclusion from this paper is the pseudo gap maybe or most likely property of bismuth oxide, nothing related to copper oxide. So if you read the paper, of course many people don't like it. So I just show the single atomic layer ion cell RSTO. So this one cell, we also deposit a part of the tuning cell. We measure it. You can see on top of this one cell, you see the very big, very strong coherent peak with the gap size around 20 milliUA. On the second layer, that's a semiconducting or just metallic thing, nothing special. You see the gap opening. So most likely, this guy is superconducting. And this the gap around 20 milliUA is very surprised because of this. For the bulk single crystal ion selenide, the gap is around 2.2 milliUA. The TC around 8 and 9. But for single atomic layer ion selenide on STO, the gap is 20 milliUA. If this 20 milliUA is a superconducting gap, then, if the mechanism is same, you expect the TC around 90 or 80. So this is maybe we are, you know, mimic the copper oxide on the thing. So this is the. So we also did the control experiment. We deposited one cell answer on graphene, where the interface bonding is very, very weak. We don't see any gap even at 2 Kelvin temperature. So this bonding between the ion selenide and STO, very important. I think Professor Huang talked about the electrophonon coupling because the polaron maybe very important here. So in any case, we also see the gap is not a V, just a U, okay? And then I just skip this one. Then to confirm this one, we have to do the transport. This is the STO substrate after deposition of one cell ion selenide. You can see similar morphology. So on every terrace, we have a single atomic layer ion selenide. So this is the ideal field. And then on top of this one, we covered the ion telluride, and we check the by this the aberration corrected TEM. We see the interface very, very sharp. Okay? And then you see the TC, onset TC already over the 50 Kelvin. Okay, only for one monolayer. And my colleague, former colleague, the Professor Jia, now at the Shanghai Jiao University, using the in situ four probe measurement to show the evidence of transition temperature over the 100 Kelvin. And the Professor Wang at our department, Professor Feng Fudan University, in collaboration with Professor Moland at Stanford, see the Meissner effect at 65 is higher than any bulk ion-based superconductor. This is the only one monolayer film. So look like it's similar to the copper oxide, okay? And also many group, Professor Zhou and IOP in Beijing, Professor Tseng and Stanford, and Professor Takahashi and Tohoku University, they see, yeah, the U gap, the gap is isotropic, very similar to F wave. And then Professor Feng, particularly my former student now working using STM determining, so the pairing is very simple, F wave pairing. And also, by the observation of this replica, Professor Shen, in collaboration with Professor Li Donghai, they argue also my original idea, electron-photon coupling by this F2 interface is very important. Okay? Of course, many people don't like it, but there are a lot of debate. Okay? And also, I talked to Professor Marvin Cooking at the Berkeley. They said, electron-photon coupling in this system probably very important. Okay? So now, we only grew the half intercell. For copper oxide, we have two side charge phase 1. So if you make two samples together and bond them together, maybe TC can be higher. Okay? Yeah. So we are my group. So I think after the first transport, Professor Bolivich write this figure. So he lists this one is probably the second system with a TC high in the liquid boiling temperature and ambient condition. So recently, there are a lot of group study it. So I don't know the if you read this paper, beginning of this year, so look like the electron photon coupling BCF can go to the room temperature since we have this around 100 for this monolayer system. So we need a lot of people come in to work on this very simple system to nail down the mechanism for pairing. So my group is working on the different substrate, different over layer, and also put another charged layer to search for the new system with a very high TC. So I think I should stop here. I'd like to acknowledge the team at Tsinghua University, my former colleague Professor Jia, now he runs the bigger group and Shanghai, and the transport was done by Professor Wang Yayu and our department, Professor Wang Jian. My former students at Peking University, Professor Liu and IOP, Apex collaboration with Professor Zhou, IOP, Professor Shen, Stanford. This is STEM, Professor Chen at Tohoku University, and Professor Jin, IOP. STM, also we collaborate with Jenny Hoffman at Harvard, and optics, and also for the BISC sample provided by Dr. Gu in the BNL. And I get a lot of the advice from this great theoretician, particularly So Cheng. So we are very good friend. His theory, he always asked me to do to confirm his theory. Quantum anomalous hall is one of the successful examples. We are still collaborating. So of course, there are many other advice. So finally, I just show you, I just summarize so MB plus F, MB plus apex, if you can further combine the in situ transport, you may looking for the many, many quantum phenomena controlled at a single atomic level. So that's the only information I want to share with our students. Get atomic control of your film, your crystal, with precisely controlled carrier density or a very, very low impure density, then you will find a lot of exciting physics. So with that, I would thank you very much for attention.
Thank you very much for a very interesting talk. Mm-hmm. And the floor is open for questions now.
In terms of the superconductor, has there been any theoretical calculations or measurements about critical current? What would be more interesting is how many amperes per centimeter for the equivalent of surface currents.
I have no that kind of information. I will think of that.
Saying that your films, your
That's because the, for the, this flow down technique for the synthesis group, we have this intrinsic problem of this molecule of selenium. So if you, during the growth, you put the bismuth and the selenium together, but the selenium is the molecule. So you need a long time, very slow growth to break the molecule, so make this polychromatic growth. But in the MV, just like gallium arsenide, you can suppress much higher selenium molecule to concentrate the formation of defect of weakness of selenium. So this is a little bit different.
And my second question is for the bottom anomalous effect. What is the thing that is limiting the observation at that temperature? How would you be able to push it up?
Yeah, that's a good question. For this particular system, I think the quality of film is still not perfect. We still maybe have some certain amount of density of defect there, or some cluster, very small amount. It's, we can further, there is space to optimize further. I think not the, still a lot of work being done. Still the quality not the, like gallium arsenide, it's perfect. You know, the same crystal. You still, if you look at the summer area, you still have the defect. Also, the doping may not very homogeneous. Genius. They say that chromium maybe too very close, and some of them quite far, right? So it's not very uniform. I think this is the thing we should optimize to get a better sample.
In the quantum anomalous,
for example,
if you raise the temperature, you look at the whole function of magnetic field, what carrier density do you expect? What is the two-dimensional density of the electron that you get if you just raise the temperature to a point where OXY is linear?
What's the ordinary hall
effect? What is a carrier density, actually?
Yeah, what's the carrier density?
The carrier is around 10 to the, let's see, around 10 to the 17.
The centimeter cube?
Yeah.
So what does it make?
Centimeter squared.
10 to the 17 centimeter squared, so it's 5 orders of magnitude than the semiconducting structure.
Yeah. After the magnetic doping.
Yeah,
I think I have the data. I have the data. We see the that's the cubic intercube. So this is the carrier around here. So this is the unit.
So
13,
centimeters.
So I think if we further optimize, maybe this can be one order decrease. Tissue can be high, the temperature can be higher. This still.
So when you tunnel into this ferroxylenium, do you expect to see the strontium titanate formers, or maybe do you see them?
To the tunneling of this, we
the ferroxylenium.
Yeah, we don't see this this phonon, the peak, the peak. No.
Do you expect to see them because of this?
Some of the, even the conventional system, you don't see this phonon. Some of the phonon peak are very easy. Even the, for the electron phonon coupling the superconductor, some of the systems do not show this phonon peak in the side of the coherent peak. So I think we don't see. We don't see that. Somehow. You can see? Yeah, this is the, we have two gaps, this bigger gap. If you see something, but a little bit noisy, somehow. If we see that, we may argue about electron phonon coupling, but we don't see that.
Any last question? If not, let's thank Professor Xue again.